Hello and welcome to The Vote. You join me, Frank LeDuc, and my guest today, Alison Lewis, who's been involved with the campaign to save the cycle track at Preston Park. Alison, thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you for inviting me.
I just want to try and get my head around, what's your involvement with the cycle track at Preston Park? Are you a racing cyclist or...?
No, I'm afraid I'm not a racing cyclist. That takes too many hours of training than I have available. However, I use the track a lot. So there's two main roles I use the track in. One is as a British Cycling Breeze champion, which is all about getting women on their bikes more. I run regular coaching and training sessions for women at the track at the moment.
All ages?
Absolutely all ages. Yes, all ages, all bikes, all fitness. Anyone is welcome. All they need is a bike and a helmet.
Fantastic.
So we've actually taken advantage of the racing not happening and taken the slots that are now available for that. And then also on Saturday mornings, the Preston Park Youth Cycle Club meets at the track and has done for many years, and I'm one of the regular coaches there.
And are the youth cyclists, are they people who are racing or into racing or getting started or
a combination? A lot of them are interested in racing. So a lot of the youth riders there, when the racing was happening at the track, would on Wednesday evenings be racing on their track bikes there.
Yeah.
But there are also quite a few youngsters there who don't race, just love being on their bikes, love getting the coaching, love the workout they get with us,
yeah.
And then go out riding with their families. So a bit of a combination in the youth club, but I would say the youth club is more race orientated than the women's group that I run.
And there's been an issue with the track, hasn't there? I mean, we've had this campaign to save the track. There's been quite a few sort of fears about what the future holds, really, there. There's been no racing this season.
No, that's right.
Just take me back. What's the problem and how long have we known about that?
Well, it originated with a fatality at a very similar track in Portsmouth a couple of years ago, where a track racer was pushed into the fence in the race,
yes,
and died as a result of his injuries. As a result, British Cycling then decided they would start to look at all of the outdoor cycle tracks to check the safety.
And British Cycling's like the governing body for the sport, if you like.
Exactly. So it's British Cycling who say it's okay for us to have the racing at the track.
Okay.
So they came to Preston Park track, actually, is the first one that they inspected. And looking at the state of the fencing, and also certain aspects like curb that's next to the fencing, it was deemed unsafe to race. It's still safe for coaching, still safe for individuals to go down and ride and train, but the nature of racing, especially on track bikes, which don't have any brakes.
Okay, oh, crikey.
So it's very exciting racing to watch.
I spend most of my time on my bike these days, clinging onto the brakes for dear life.
Very exciting. So, but if you're down there on a road bike with brakes or a mountain bike, any other kind of bike, it's still quite safe. We're just more aware when we coach there to ask the riders to stay at least a metre away from the fencing. So that's where it started.
Because it's not an old... I mean, I know it's probably the oldest velodrome in the country, but it's not the oldest fence by any means, is it? It's quite new.
No, a relatively new fence, but...
what everyone thought was a safe design, we found
is not, actually. When reviewed, when looked at again, there's an extensive report from British Cycling with lots of photographs that they took at the track showing how the nature of the mesh in the fence could be quite dangerous in terms of if you were pushed up against it, you could get your fingers trapped in it if you reached out. So you need more of a kind of solid smooth fence. There's curbs, as I say, that actually jut out now because the fence has been moved behind the curb,
right,
whereas the old fence was in front of the curb. And there's also a gate that is up near the pavilion with quite a big gap underneath.
Right.
And when I have been coaching there, there have been dogs and small children. Even though we lock the gates, they
coming
squeeze
through
under that fence, decide it's okay to run across the track when you have people coming across. When you've got brakes, you can brake. But when you're on a track bike, that is extremely dangerous. So that's why British Cycling kind of said no. This needs to be altered before we can have racing again.
Okay, so that we'll talk about how that might be tackled shortly. One of the things that, of course, I've seen, you know, it's been hard to miss, save Preston Park Cycle Track, but the track itself is okay.
There is no issue for British Cycling with the tarmac of the track. I wouldn't go so far as to say it's okay as a regular user. There's a great big seam down the middle. And if you've got thin tyres, it's a little bit tricky if you get stuck in that seam. So I wouldn't say, oh no, the tarmac's great. It will need work doing very soon, I would say, but it's not the key issue that British Cycling had.
It's not the pressing issue at the moment.
No.
And I mean, the other thing, of course, that happens once you start looking at a place like, I say the cycle track, I mean, if you like, let's call it the velodrome for the moment, but in the round, is that other issues then come to light. So you've got a stand there. The council have said, oh, I think the roof needs to come off the stand to make that safe. Again, this presumably just adds to the cost.
Yes. So the grandstand has always been a fairly basic thing. It's just concrete steps, like you used to get at the old style football stadiums.
It's over 100 years old, isn't it?
It is, yes. So to be fair, we weren't used to such luxury before. So it's been there for quite a while. As you say, with the council and other people suddenly paying more attention to the track, they started to notice the other structures around. So they've now said that the roof needs to come off the grandstand. It's the roof that's the biggest danger.
Okay.
I think it's asbestos or something like that. So that's come to light. They've said they need to take the roof off.
Okay.
But they're not going to take away all the steps. That would cost too much.
A good or a bad thing, the roof coming off the stand? Mixed feelings.
When the stand was open for use, it's now fenced off. When it was open for use at the youth club, the parents used to be able to sit there in some shelter, gave them somewhere to watch.
Yes.
Now it's fenced off, they can't use it. When the roof comes off, it'll be no good in bad weather.
Yes.
At the moment, it's quite a favourite hangout of the local youths, to be honest. So when I'm there on a Wednesday and Friday evening, quite a gang gather there. It's a sheltered place for them to gather, get up to a little bit of like mischief. Without the roof, it may be less of a hangout in bad weather. Don't know.
See how that goes. Yeah. I appreciate having sort of the major problems that some places sometimes have, but have you got things like CCTV to...
Not that I know of. No, I've been at the track many, many hours and I have never noticed any cameras anywhere around. So that would actually be very helpful.
As part of the sort of changes that are taking place. I mean, I imagine with things like coming in and finding broken glass on the track when you're riding with tyres is not a happy thing to find.
We often get that on a Saturday morning with the youth club. We have to turn up quite a lot earlier to sweep the track, because the kids tend to throw bottles from the grandstand onto the track, always have. So CCTV would be great. There's also been talk of, for the evenings, it's getting very dark now, I'm going to have to stop my evening sessions, it's just too dark.
Okay.
Some flood lighting would be fantastic, or even low-level lighting.
Yeah.
So there's other things that would really improve the facility, would increase the amount of hours it could be used.
Make it more viable. Viable. Because, I mean, I wanted to ask you about the cost. I mean, I mean, obviously, if we were to relay the track in an ideal world, you're talking about £800,000 worth of expense.
It's a big track, very big track.
That's not going to happen at the moment. There was a meeting last week at the council. You were one of the speakers, actually, and I think you got a reasonable result, didn't you?
Yeah, we did. No, we were pleased. We were very pleased that the council have said yes. We will come up with the money to match fund British Cycling. So
you've got two organisations that are
exactly.
seem to be happy to put some money in. What needs spending?
There's £285,000 needed to replace the fencing for it to be deemed okay for racing.
Okay.
So British Cycling have said we'll match fund.
Yes.
We'll come up with half of it if the council comes up with the other half.
Okay.
So that surely helped. Because if the council said no, they wouldn't see that money ever again for British Cycling.
Yes.
And I understand that the funding for the match funding from the council is going to come from a fund generated from the regeneration of the old co-op on the London Road.
So the council would argue, actually, this is money that's been paid by developers to help improve the local area rather than coming out of your or my council
Absolutely.
Tax or whatever.
Absolutely. So it seems like quite a good win-win in terms of how the funding has been worked out. So we're very pleased with that result. There are some other things we heard in the meeting that those of us involved with the track are thinking, ooh, that might make things a bit tricky. But in terms of, can we just get the racing started again next year? Those that race in the Sussex County Racing League, that's a good result.
Oh, that's great. And of course, I mean, does that £285,000 include the roof? I think that includes the cost of removing the roof. And
I understand the roof, £25,000, is going to come from another fund.
Okay.
So that's quite separate. Yes.
Because, I mean, at the meeting, I mean, we'll take a break in about a minute, but very briefly, at the meeting, you know, we heard from I think it was the Friends of Preston Park, who've got some reservations because I think they've got, that there are lots of things that in the park that, that it would be lovely to do. Do you think they left reassured?
Yes, I think they did. Well, I hope they did, because it was interesting hearing the council's reaction to their
reservations.
Reservations. And it's clear that a lot of what the Friends of Preston Park would like to have done in the park is also related to some historic structures in the park, for which there is other funding streams available.
So it looks like the council, I mean, if anything, I was going to say the council hasn't lost sight of Preston Park in some ways. This has probably helped put it up the agenda a little.
I think it's raised it in the profile for a lot of people in the city and for the council, to be honest.
OK. Well, we'll come back to that in just a second. We're going to take a short break in a moment, so please don't go away. And please don't you go away either. We're just going to watch these ads. Join us again very soon. Hello, welcome back to The Vote with me, Frank Leduc. I'm joined by Alison Lewis, who's been involved with the campaign to save the Preston Park cycle track. Alison, you've gone to the council for money, British Cycling are going to put up some money. The people who use the track themselves, have they been doing anything? I mean, what's been happening there to sort of, if you like, try and sort of generate either money? Certainly you've generated a campaign that's been hard to miss.
Yes.
What's been happening on that front?
Well, there's been two people at the forefront of the Save Preston Park campaign, Rupert Rivett and Ian Craig, and they've been doing fantastic work in raising the profile with both cyclists and Brighton public. And also they have started a crowdfunding campaign to get some funds, not to cover all the repairs, that's too much, but to get some funds to
nice,
keep the
it?
Campaign going. That would be lovely, but that's unlikely. So it's just some funds to keep the campaign going, to pay for costs like the hire of halls. There's another open meeting, for example, in October. It costs to hire a hall.
Do you know when that meeting?
19th of October, 7:30, Noyle Hall.
Noyle Hall, which is near St John's Church,
yes.
Noyle Road.
Yes.
So, and that's, what's the purpose of a meeting like that?
We're very pleased with the result of the council meeting, and we still have some reservations. So the idea of the meeting is to discuss what next, where do we go now, let's not just rest on our laurels because it's looking like there will be racing next season. There are other things that as users we believe need to be done with the track. So things such as, what about the resurfacing of the tarmac?
Yep.
How about some floodlighting? That would mean we could use it more. How about what you've just mentioned, some CCTV or other facilities like that?
Because it's not just the cyclists using the what we call the cycle track, is it?
No.
The green in the middle?
The green in the middle is leased by St Peter's Cricket Club. So it's a multi-use facility. Cricket happens in the middle in the summer. Not at the same time as the cycling.
Well, that would be
a bit tricky. Yeah, no. It's either cricket or the cycling. Yes, exactly. So the cricket club have the green in the middle.
Yep.
And they lease it from the council, and then the cycle track we can hire. If you want exclusive use,
yes,
you can hire it and use it for a group such as I do.
That cost is going to go up now, isn't it, as well, after Thursday's meeting,
yes,
by the looks of it?
It sounds like it. And that's one of our concerns.
So there's a conversation still to be had about... Because they talked about commercial charges, but I think I'm getting the impression that some of the guys who've been campaigning want to make sure there's a difference drawn between commercial users and sort of voluntary groups, if
absolutely,
you like.
Absolutely, absolutely. And to be honest, I don't know of many, if any, commercial users. So the vast majority of users are the likes of myself, who offer these sessions for free to the women on a volunteer basis, or the youth club, who do it on a volunteer basis. The racing doesn't generate money. That's the Sussex County Racing League, which is not a commercial organisation. So they are talking about taking the fees up to £50 an hour, which would not be viable for me to continue with my sessions, for example. And I understand British Cycling recommended it was £30 an hour,
right,
which is the national rate.
Okay.
So, okay, £30 an hour, maybe, but there's a big gap then from 30 to 50.
So there's still some obstacles to be overcome. It's not all quite on the Preston front.
No, certainly not. Certainly not.
Forgive me. and I mean, just the sessions you do with women at the park. I mean, I just wondered if the breeze sessions. I just wondered if you could, because you talked about those briefly at the meeting last week, and I think that actually had quite an impression on some people there who probably weren't aware of what also happens. It's not just racing at the park. No. But perhaps you could just take us through what they involve.
Yes. So on Wednesday and Friday evenings, I hire the track for an hour and a half each evening, and any woman who wants to turn up turns up for free. And I do about 45 minutes of coaching, skills practice on their bikes, so getting them better with their bike handling, quite a lot of practice of riding in groups. And then the last 45 minutes is more of a kind of training session, some harder riding round the track.
Fitness,
exactly. So it's a combination of skills and fitness. And there also happens to be quite a high level of social enjoyment of just being there with a bit of a gang of women and having a natter and a laugh as we try some things out, fall off our bikes a few times, race each other around the track in little kind of mock races and things like that. So
getting confidence up. I mean, I don't know if I can tempt you to share with me one of the things you shared with the meeting last week. You had some lovely testimonials. I don't know if you can.
Yes, in fact, I've had some more in. So the wonders of social media, after telling some of the women who I work with at the track about it, they said, oh, if you want some more words, here we have some more. So yes, the testimonial that I read out at the meeting was from the mother of two boys who come to the youth cycle track.
Okay.
And she spoke quite a bit about how the track has made a difference to her boys, who are now 7 and 13. And she had some very great words about, for example, just to pull out, it is the best place to cycle safely as a family and our place of choice to cycle together. So I think that's quite important. People don't always realise, where do kids go to ride their bikes now?
Yes.
Roads are so busy, a lot of parents don't allow them to, or it's actually quite hard to practice some skills on your bike. If you do it in an open public park, people can get a bit fed up with you, riding around on the paths, getting in the way, dogs, kids, all that kind of thing. The cycle track is very unique.
Yeah.
In that it is there for that purpose. And as this mother says, we can go there and ride around the track together as a family, knowing we're all safe.
Yes.
We can practice some skills. It'll all be good. But also some of the women wrote some lovely things to me, because a lot of them started to do sessions with me back in January. I first experimented with this in the depths. I know, the depths of winter. I experimented with it.
I'm a fair weather cyclist increasingly.
I thought January, New Year's resolutions, perhaps
very
a new
good
bike for Christmas.
Yep.
Let's put it out there and see.
Yeah.
And we had waiting lists every week.
Wow.
It was freezing cold, really not nice. But a lot of women, such as this one I'm about to quote, came because they had bikes.
Yes.
They had not been out on them on the road because they were too scared.
Yeah.
They didn't know how to ride on the road. And they saw my sessions advertised, which were an hour of coaching, followed by an hour's ride to a cafe 5 miles away and then back. So we took them out on the road and chaperoned.
I see. Now you're talking about a cafe. It's
yes
beginning to sound a bit more.
It sounds more, yes, a nice warm cafe. So, for example, here's one of my very regular riders who comes. I only started cycling in January this year. I had wanted to for a while, but didn't have the confidence to go out on the road. Then she says how she found out about my sessions. I heard that there were the sessions demonstrating good practice and skills for women to do in a safe place. I've now grown, not only as a cyclist, but as a person. And she goes on to say, I'm prone to anxiety. Shaking off any fears at the cycle track is a necessary first step for me to develop my skills on the road.
Oh, fantastic.
It's a safe place to try things out, to learn the skills, and then breeze, we can take them out on lead bike rides on the road and again introduce them safely.
Oh, fantastic. And if they want, if people want to find out more about that, can you put in British Cycling Breeze Brighton into
Absolutely.
Google or something like that?
Put in British Cycling Breeze, that will come up on Google. Also on Facebook, there is the Breeze Network Sussex and South Downs.
Sussex and South Downs.
Yes, where we advertise our rides.
Brilliant. One of the other things I wanted to ask you about as well was the off the beaten track a little, if you like, or down the round the corner a bit, the Lewis Road Cycle Path. It's just won another award. It's had sort of locally mixed reviews for some people, not least the loss of a car lane. But I mean, I guess I'd ask someone like you who cycles a lot, are we doing enough to make Brighton and Hove a cycle-friendly place?
I think we're doing a lot. I think it is one of the friendlier cities that I cycle in. However, there are some quite bizarre cycle lanes that stop and start quite suddenly. This isn't unique to Brighton, but
no.
It makes it quite hard as a cyclist who may not want to go on the roads,
yes,
and wants to use the cycle paths.
Yeah.
It's actually quite hard to get around through the city. So that Lewis Road development was great. It made it a lot easier
it's
for
cohesive.
Getting out of the city. Exactly,
okay.
Exactly.
And
yeah.
I mean, on the seafront, I mean, with a lot of the roadwork, with a lot of the roadworks on the seafront and the other stuff that's going on, the distinction between the cycle lane and the promenade has sort of disappeared in places at times. A good thing in the long run, do you think? I mean, some people are adamant that cyclists and pedestrians should be separated. Others are very keen that, for example, we follow the more continental style, where often they're together and actually, as a result, rub along better.
I have mixed views. So if I want to go along the seafront, for example, on a busy, sunny Sunday morning, I do not go on the cycle path because it's just so busy with pedestrians, many of whom are visitors to Brighton.
Yes.
They don't realise it's a cycle path.
Particularly near the pier.
Yeah. It's a bit of a nightmare, to be honest. Mm. So I choose to go on the road
yes.
at those times. Not everyone's that confident, but I say yep. to the women who ride with me, listen, if you're riding then, get off your bike and push it.
Yeah.
It's only for a short while and then you can get back on. So I think it needs some tolerance on all ways. More education for non-cyclists,
yeah.
But also some tolerance from the cyclists.
And I guess that's true because just across cycling across the city as a whole. I mean, we sometimes hear sort of standoffs between drivers and cyclists in sort of the letters pages of the Argus, etc. But I think that plea for tolerance goes wider.
Absolutely.
I mean, I'm a cyclist and a driver.
Yeah, and most cyclists are. Yeah. Most cyclists are.
Listen, Alison, thank you so much for joining us. I do hope good luck with the campaign.
Thank you.
And thank you very much for watching The Vote. Watch again very soon. Goodbye for now.